Okay, so today's topic is suppositories and pessaries in continuation for yesterday's class. Okay, so what do you mean by suppositories and pessaries? Whatever we had discussion yesterday, what do you mean by the term suppositories? Suppositories are nothing but these are solid unit dosage forms that contains API and bases intended for rectal administration for desired therapeutic effect. When you say desired therapeutic effect, for suppositories, you need to talk about localized action as well as systemic action. For desired, localized and systemic effect. So what is the mechanism of suppository? These suppository, after insertion into the rectum, they will melt, they will soften, thereby they will get dissolved. Coming to the definition of pessaries. What do you mean by the term pessaries? Pessaries are solid unit dosage forms that contains API and base intended for rectal administration or vaginal administration? It is a vaginal administration intended for vaginal administration for desired therapeutic effect. The principle involved in the suppositories and pessaries both are same. Okay, so what are all the topics we have dealt yesterday? We have dealt with definition of suppositories and pessaries. We have dealt with what are the types of suppositories and pessaries. We have dealt with advantages and disadvantages of suppositories and pessaries, followed by ideal properties of ideal properties for a base for suppositories and pessaries, followed by we have dealt with what are the different types of bases for suppositories. Let's go on to the topic, today's topic, in continuation with your first topic. So we have stopped at discussing different types of bases. What are the four main types of bases that are available? Oily bases, hydrophilic bases, water dispersible bases, emulsifying bases. So first we have completed with oily bases. Oily bases again divided into three types: cocoa butter base or theobroma oil base. Next, followed by emulsified theobroma oil base, followed by synthetic hard fat or hydrogenated oil bases. Now we will move on to hydrophilic bases. So under hydrophilic bases, we are going to discuss about glycerinated gelatin or glycerogelatin base. So the first point, this substance has many properties that make it as a desirable base for suppositories. Foremost among these, its hydrophilic character. So I already discussed about what are the ideal properties for a base to be added into suppositories. So when you talk about ideal properties, this glycerinated gelatin also holds all the ideal properties that we have discussed earlier. And foremost advantage of this glycerinated gelatin is that this particular glycerinated gelatin comes under the category of hydrophilic bases. When we say hydrophilic bases, nothing but these are water loving bases. Ultimately, we can say that glycerinated gelatin has hydrophilic character. So hydrophilic character is very important for suppositories. Why hydrophilic character is very important? As I told you earlier that after insertion of a particular suppository into the rectal cavity, it should be in a position to absorb the moisture from the rectal cavity. When it absorbs the moisture, thereby it will start swelling, thereby it will just soften, thereby it will start dissolving. Okay, now coming to the second point of your glycerinated gelatin. Suppositories made with glycerinated gelatin slowly dissolve in the aqueous secretion and provide a slow continuous release of medications. So any suppository that has been prepared from the glycerinated gelatin base, what will happen? It will dissolve slowly in the aqueous secretions and thereby it will provide a slow continuous release of medication. Coming to the third point, glycerinated gelatin may be used to prepare all types of suppository and it is particularly useful in vaginal suppository. If you can remember in the previous slides, I have depicted one table, right, discussing about different types of suppositories. In that, if you can see about vaginal suppository, especially under Pessaries, I have given a column called as base column. Under base column, I have given an example called as glycerogelatin. Here the same point it is saying. Glycerinated gelatin, it is used in preparing all the types of suppositories, but particularly it is used in vaginal suppository. What is the base used in the preparation of vaginal suppository? The base is nothing but glycerinated gelatin or glycerogelatin base. Next point. It is well adapted for the incorporation of solid extracts such as belladonna. And this glycerinated gelatin, you know, it has a very good peculiar character. It can adopt any sort of solid extracts. So when you say solid extracts, the extracts that have been extracted from the plants. Here the example given as belladonna. Belladonna is nothing but it is a herb used in the treatment of stressma. Okay. Because suppositories are not only in allopathy, they are also in Ayurvedic side. Okay. So belladonna herb extract can be incorporated into glycerinated gelatin. And after incorporation is glycerinated gelatin, this particular mixture will be poured into some molds. Thereby, you can prepare a suppository. That suppository name is nothing but called as belladonna suppository. What is the use of belladonna? Belladonna is used in the treatment of stress conditions. Whenever a particular is suffering from increased stress conditions, under that particular conditions, you can use this belladonna suppository. It may also be used for suppositories containing boric acid, bromides, chloral hydrate, iodide, iodoform, and other drugs. Not only that belladonna extracts and all, it will incorporate, but also there are some other APIs also it will incorporate. The other APIs are like your boric acid, bromides, chloral hydrate, iodide, iodoform, and other drugs. We'll move on to the next slide now. Care should be taken in the selection of type of gelatin used in suppository. It is very important, ma. If you can remember during your classes, I would have discussed something about capsules. What do you mean by the term capsule? Capsules are nothing but solid unit dosage form that contains API and other ingredients intended for oral administration as well as ophthalmic administration. Do you remember? I have discussed this. So, for desired therapeutic effect, when you say capsule, capsule is made up of what? Gelatin. So, what is the source of gelatin? I think you would have remembered about pork skin, calf skin and all. Okay, that is the source of your gelatin. And here, when you say gelatin, gelatin is not a single term. There are types of gelatins that are present in the market. There are two types of gelatins that are present in the market. Remember, ma. Gelatin A and gelatin B. So care should be taken while formulating suppository, which type of gelatin you are going to incorporate into your suppository formulation. That is very important. So what is the discussion here? There are two types of gelatins that are present in the market. One is gelatin A and gelatin B. So while formulating a suppository, it is very important to select what type of gelatin you are going to incorporate into your formulation. There are two major types of gelatin, each of which has its specific applications. Now we'll go on to what are the two types of gelatin and what are its applications. Please remember about this gelatin concept, ma. Types of gelatin and what exactly they are. What is the difference between type A gelatin and type B gelatin? Because in your upcoming studies, like when you go to third year or fourth year, you will come across this particular capsules topic again. You will come across. Under capsules, you'll be discussing mainly about the gelatin because capsule is made up of what? Gelatin. So, the types of gelatin are type A and type B. What is type A? Type A is derived from an acid-treated precursor and has a pH between 3.8 and 4.8. So, type A gelatin will be obtained on acid treatment. Okay, and the pH is between 3.8 and 4.5. Okay. This gelatin has an isoelectric point between pH 7 and 9. Okay, it has an isoelectric point between pH 7 and 9. In solution, type A gelatin carries a strong positive charge and behaves as a cationic agent. Okay, type A gelatin is available under the trade name of PharmaGel A. So, what are the points to be discussed under type A gelatin? The first point is type A gelatin is obtained by acid treatment. Okay. And the pH of type A gelatin is 3.8 and 4.5. And what is the isoelectric point of gelatin here? It is between pH 7 and 9. In solution, this type A gelatin carries a positive charge. Whenever a particular excipient carries a positive charge, ultimately that particular excipient will behave as a cationic, because cationic is meant for positive charge. Type A gelatin is available under the trade name of Formagel A, because so as chemical name it is a gelatin, okay, it is a type A gelatin, but when we go into the market you will be calling with a brand name or something called as trade name. So this type A gelatin is available under the trade name as Formagel A, okay. Next, type B gelatin. So type B gelatin is also called as Formagel B, that is nothing but a trade name. It is made from alkali treated precursor and has a pH between 5 and 7. There it is an acid treated precursor, here it is an alkali treated precursor. There it is a pH, it is between 3.8 and 4.5. Here the pH is between 5 and 7. Since this pH is above its isoelectric point, pH 4.7 to 5, it carries a negative charge. What is the isoelectric point here? It is in between 4.7 to 5. There the isoelectric point is 7 and 9. So as it is having isoelectric point at pH 4.7 to 5, it carries a negative charge. And when it carries a negative charge, ultimately we can say that it behaves as an anionic agent. Unless its pH is lowered below 4.7, then it becomes cationic. Here we are saying that this particular type B gelatin has an isoelectric point between 4.7 to 5. When this isoelectric point, when it is lowered, that pH when it is lowered below your 4.7, ultimately what happens when the pH is lowered below 4.7? It falls under your cationic category. Okay. Are you clear, clear with the difference between type A and type B gelatin? Okay. Next, we will move on to the next slide. Glycerinated gelatin is also the best and most reliable vehicle for the effective use of antiseptics such as hexyl resorcinol, nitromersol and femoral in suppository form. And they are giving an advantage about your glycerinated gelatin. If you opt for glycerinated gelatin as a base, it acts as a most reliable vehicle, okay, most effective vehicle for incorporation of antiseptics. So the antiseptics examples are hexyl resorcinol, nitromersol and femoral. Okay, if you want to prepare a suppository, that too for antiseptics such as hexyl resorcinol, nitromersol and femoral, you can opt for a effective base. That effective base is nothing but your glycerinated gelatin base. Okay. Many formula have been recommended for glycerinated gelatin, differing in the proportion of glycerin, gelatin and water. So if you want to know about what exactly this glycerinated gelatin is, when you say glycerinated, you can, in this particular name, you can see two things. Glycerin will be present, obviously, and gelatin will be present. So when glycerin and gelatin is present, there should be some composition present. So glycerin, gelatin and water, these are the three ingredients together will form something called as glycerinated gelatin. So in order to prepare this glycerinated gelatin, ultimately what you require some composition. Composition is nothing but some proportion. Do you remember in our laboratory hours, we have discussed about something about phenol water, how to prepare that phenol water, cinnamon water. So ultimately there are some proportions to mix this, and to prepare a suitable ingredient. So in glycerinated gelatin, it makes use of three ingredients, glycerin, gelatin and water. And these three ingredients are according to the proportions prescribed, according to BPC, USP and EP. So British Pharmacopoeia, USP Pharmacopoeia and EP. If you want to prepare a suppository for US market, you need to follow the composition prescribed for USP market. Okay. If you want to prepare a suppository for European market, you need to follow European pharmacopoeia. If you want to prepare a composition for the British market, you need to follow British pharmacopoeia. So the ratio of gelatin, glycerin and water for according to British pharmacopoeia is 25:40:100. 25 parts of gelatin, 40 parts of glycerin, 100 parts of water. According to USP, 20 parts of gelatin, 70 parts of glycerin, and 100 parts of water. According to European pharmacopoeia, 14 parts of gelatin, 70 parts of glycerin, and 100 parts of water. This is the proportion used for the preparation of glycerinated gelatin. Are you clear? Yeah, next one. Under the category of your hydrophilic bases, the next one is polyethylene glycols, also called as macrogols. Polyethylene glycols, also called as macrogols. Macrogols is nothing but a brand name for your polyethylene glycols. What do you mean by polyethylene glycols? I used to call like PEG, P-E-G, nothing but polyethylene glycols. Okay, so the first point, polyethylene glycols are polymers of ethylene oxide and water. What are polyethylene glycols chemically? These are nothing but polymers of ethylene oxide and water, prepared to various chain lengths, molecular weights, and physical states. So, when you say prepared to various chain lengths, molecular weights, and physical states, that means that you need to assume that these polyethylene glycols will be available in different grades. Do you remember I used to say in your regular classes, PEG 200, PEG 400, PEG 600, PEG 800, PEG 1000. All these are nothing but different grades of polyethylene glycols. Why different grades of polyethylene glycols? Different grades will be prepared according to their chain length. When the chain length gets increased, its molecular weight will get increased. When the molecular weight will get increased, its physical state also will get changed. Okay. So, second point, polyethylene glycols exist as liquids when their average molecular weight ranges from 200 to 600 ma. Whenever a polyethylene glycol, the molecular weight is 200 to 600, that polyethylene glycol will exist as liquid ma. Whenever the polyethylene glycol molecular weight it is more than 1000 or above 2000, when it reaches above 2000, ultimately it will behave like a wax like solids. Is it clear? So here the first point says that these polyethylene glycols are prepared according to their various chain lengths, molecular weights, and physical states. So as it is said, so when the molecular weight is between 200 to 600, these polyethylene glycols, the physical state will be liquid. Okay, when it is about to reach 1000 or it is more than 1000, ultimately the physical state will change to a wax like solid. Okay, next point. Their water solubility, hygroscopicity, and vapor pressure decreases with increased average molecular weight. When the molecular weight is keep on getting increased, what happens? There will be a decrease in water solubility, hygroscopicity, and vapor pressure. This is another point. So, next point, the polyethylene glycol suppository can be prepared by both molding method and cold compression method. Okay, if you employ polyethylene glycols as a base for suppository, okay, you can prepare that particular suppository by employing two methods. Either you can go for molding method or you can go for cold compression method. Several combination of polyethylene glycols have been prepared for suppository bases having desired consistency and different physical characteristics. So you can opt for several combination of polyethylene glycols. You can take 200 to 400 polyethylene glycols, or you can take one polyethylene glycol as a base that you can add the other one. So several combination of polyethylene glycols you can prepare as a suppository basis. So why you will go for combinations? In order to obtain desired consistency and in order to get some different physical characteristics for your suppositories. Is it clear? This is the advantage of having combination of polyethylene glycols. Next type of base is soap glycerin. Next type of base is slope glycerin. We are discussing under the topic of hydrophilic bases. So hydrophilic bases, the examples are three. The first example is glycerinated gelatin base. The next example is polyethylene glycols, otherwise called as macrogols. And the third one, what we are discussing now, is soap glycerin. Okay, first point. Soap glycerin is nothing but a stearine soap. Okay, that is something called as curd soap, and sodium stearate is used as a suppository base. These are the synonyms of your stearine soap, curd soap, or sodium stearate. Okay. The soap used in this base is formed in glycerin solution by interaction between stearic acid and sodium carbonate. How this stearine soap will be prepared? This stearine soap will be prepared in the solution of glycerin. This stearine soap will be prepared in the solution of glycerin on reaction between two ingredients. What are they? Stearic acid and sodium carbonate. How the stearine soap is prepared? It is prepared by reaction. It is prepared by a reaction that is taking place between your stearic acid and sodium carbonate in presence of what? Glycerin solution. It has certain advantages over gelatin for making glycerin sufficiently hard for suppository. When compared to your glycerinated gelatin, when compared to your gelatin that is present in glycerinated gelatin, okay, it has several advantages. So if you select this glycerin, what glycerin will do, you know, it will sufficiently harden your suppository. First one, a larger quantity of glycerin can be incorporated, actually up to 90% of the mass. If you consider the entire mass for the preparation of the soap glycerin, out of that 90%, 95% of your particular mass will be constituted with your glycerin. And soap assists the action of glycerin, whereas gelatin does not. Okay, so what soap will do? This soap just assists the action of the glycerin. So it will induce the action of glycerin, but gelatin will not induce any action. Okay, so the disadvantage is that soap glycerin suppositories are very hygroscopic and required to be wrapped in waxed paper or pure tin foil and protected from the atmosphere. Here two things we need to look upon. Okay, one thing, the advantage of soap glycerin, and the other thing is disadvantage of soap glycerin. As glycerin constitutes about 95%, it will ensure the suppository to be prepared at a harder rate. And when you talk about this particular something called as your soap glycerin, the disadvantage of this soap glycerin is that they are very hygroscopic in nature. And why they are very hygroscopic? Ultimately, everyone can think about soap glycerin. When you say soap, ultimately it will absorb the moisture. Okay, that means that it will have more hygroscopic character. As there is more hygroscopic character, ultimately if you prepare the suppository that to be prepared from soap glycerin as a base, that particular suppository should be wrapped in a waxed paper or pure tin foil, and these particular suppositories should be protected from the atmosphere. That how your advantages and disadvantages of your soap glycerin. Glycerin will ensure the hardening of your suppository, but at the same time, the soap glycerin base is more hygroscopic in nature, so you need to wrap it in a waxed paper, or it should be wrapped in a pure tin foil, and it should be protected from the atmosphere. Why? Because of its highly hygroscopic nature. Next, coming to your next type of bases, water dispersible bases. Next type of bases are water dispersible bases. Okay. Yeah. Several non-ionic surfactants closely related chemically to the polyethylene glycols have been developed as suppository vehicles. Okay. So water dispersible bases are nothing but these are something additional that should be added to your base. So you have a polyethylene glycol. Okay. So to that polyethylene glycol, you need to add a vehicle such as your non-ionic surfactant. Okay, these are chemically closely related to your polyethylene glycols. Okay, many of these bases can be used for formulating both water-soluble and oil-soluble drugs. The advantage of water-dispersible bases is that these particular bases help in formulating two types of drugs, for water-soluble as well as oil-soluble drugs. The water dispersible bases offer the advantage of storage and handling at elevated temperature, because in preparation of suppositories, the care must be taken while melting. Okay. And the care must be taken while storing your suppository. So through this water soluble bases, this particular water soluble bases will offer an additional advantage like storage and handling at elevated temperature. with claims for broad drug compatibility, non-support of microbial growth, non-toxicity and non-sensitivity. What these water-soluble bases will claim for? Broad drug compatibility. What exactly we require by formulation of any dosage form? We require broad drug compatibility. Okay, whatever water dispersible base you select, whatever drug we select, both should be compatible with the each other. And non-support of microbial growth. It should not induce any sort of microbial growth. Because when we say water dispersible bases, when water is present, ultimately you will be expecting something called as microbial growth. But your water dispersible bases should claim for non-support of microbial growth. And after that, non-toxicity and non-sensitivity. It also produces non-toxic to the formulation and it should not cause any sort of toxicity. And at the same time, it should be non-sensitivity. That means that it should not cause any sort of irritation to the mucosal membrane of the rectum. Okay. The surfactants most commonly used in suppository formulations are Tween, Mirs, Span, Aerosol. Okay, have a note on these examples. The surfactants most commonly used in suppository formulations are Tween, Mirs, Span, and Aerosol. Okay, these are the examples. These surfactants may be used alone, blended, or in combination with other suppository vehicle materials to yield a wide range of melting points and consistencies. So these particular non-surfactants can be used alone as a base for the formulation of suppository, or it can be used in combination with the other suppository vehicle materials. For example, you can take some other base and to that base you can add as a vehicle of as a surfactant vehicle to that particular base, this particular surfactants, the finally to yield a wide range of melting points and consistency. The only target for your suppository, you need to have high melting range and it should have good consistency. When the melting range is not too high, ultimately what happens? You will end up with degradation of your suppository. Is it clear? Next category is emulsifying bases. The fourth type of suppository bases are emulsifying bases. You can make a note on the examples. Masa estrinum. It is an example for your emulsifying bases. Masa estrinum. Masupol. Vitapsol. Masupol. Vitapsol. Vico B bases, dehydrase bases, emulsified propylene glycol derivatives. Please make a note about this. Examples for emulsifying bases. That's all about four types of bases. The first base is oily bases, okay, oligogenous bases or what? Fatty bases, okay, followed by hydrophilic bases, followed by water dispersible bases, followed by emulsifying bases. By this, we complete different types of bases for your suppositories. Next. Yeah, coming to the next topic, method of preparation of suppositories. Method of preparation of suppositories. Yeah, there are three types of methods for the preparation of suppository. The first method is hand molding method. It's very interesting, ma. Just listen. It is the oldest and simplest method of suppository preparation and may be used when only a few suppositories are to be prepared in a cocoa butter base. Okay. Hand molding method is the oldest method and it is a simplest method. The drawback of this hand molding method is that if you want to prepare only few suppositories, you can opt for hand molding method. If you want to prepare on a large scale, you cannot opt for this hand molding method. And the prime importance will be given for a base is cocoa butter base. As I told you before that, the major important base used in the preparation of your suppository will be your cocoa butter base. The most commonly used base in the suppository preparation is your cocoa butter base. It has the advantage of avoiding the necessity of heating the cocoa butter. So you can also avoid heating of your cocoa butter. It is not mandatory that all the time you heat your cocoa butter and do your suppositories. Okay, by hand molding method, you can also avoid necessity of heating the cocoa butter. A plastic like mass is prepared by triturating grated cocoa butter and active ingredients in a mortar. The mass is formed, then rolled into a uniform cylinder with a large spatula or small flat board on a pile tile. The cylinder is then cut into an appropriate number of pieces which are rolled on one end to produce a conical shape. What is the method of preparation under hand molding method? What you need to do, you know, you need to weigh cocoa butter and you need to weigh your active ingredient. After weighing this broth, what you need to do? Just you need to transfer cocoa butter and your active ingredients into a mortar. After transferring into a mortar, you need to prepare a plastic like mass. How to prepare this plastic like mass? It can be prepared by triturating your grated cocoa butter with your API. After preparation of plastic like mass, this particular mass is then it should be converted into a ball in the palm of the hands. It is something like preparation of your chapati mass. Okay, in order to prepare a chapati mass, what you will do, you will take the chapati powder, and to that you will add some water and you will just grate it till you get a ball like mass. And what you will do after getting ball like mass, okay, how will you do that ball like mass? While just rotating in your palm of your hand, you will prepare this ball like mass. Then after that, what you have to do, then this ball like mass should be rolled into a uniform cylinder with the help of large spatula or small flat board on a pile tile. Okay, just you need to take small piece of a tile. Onto that particular tile, you just need to roll the ball like mass onto the pile tile, okay, till you get a uniform cylinder like mass. You can take the help of large spatula to roll onto the pile tile. Okay, that particular cylinder is then cut into the appropriate number of pieces. Okay, it has to be cut it into appropriate number of small pieces. That particular small pieces, again they should be rolled at one end to produce a conical shape. So everyone are aware how the suppository looks like. Okay, just imagine that you have taken cocoa butter, that cocoa butter along with the cocoa butter, you have taken an API, both have been put it into a mortar, and you have been grating the cocoa butter along with your API. That is nothing but called as trituration. On trituration, you will be getting a plastic like mass. Okay, that plastic like mass you need to roll onto the palm of your hands until it will become a ball like structure. After that particular ball should be rolled onto a pile like tile, okay, with the help of a long spatula, in order to prepare what? Uniform cylinder. Okay, after preparing uniform cylinder like mass, then you need to cut small pieces, okay, up small pieces in order to prepare your suppository. That small pieces again you need to roll at one end to produce a conical shape. So here, effective hand rolling requires considerable practice and skill. So if an unknown person, if you ask, which they don't have any knowledge, and if you ask that person to prepare chapati, they will not be in a position to prepare. So in order to prepare chapati mals also, you need to know what a considerable practice and skill should be required. In the same way here also, in order to prepare these suppositories also, effective hand rolling, in order to have effective hand rolling, it requires considerable practice and skill. The suppository pipe or cylinder tends to crack or hollow in the center. Always this will be a problem. Even though you have a prepared like cylinder like structure or pipe like structure, there is a chance that this particular cylinder like structure can be cracked in between, or this particular cylinder like structure, there will be a hollow in the center, especially when the mass is insufficiently kneaded and softened. When you don't insufficiently, kneading is nothing but so preparing a consistent mass, plastic like mass, okay. And if that kneading and softening is not there with your plastic mass, ultimately you will end up with cracking of your cylinder or having a hollow in the center. These problems may arise. Next comes your compression molding. Next type of method is compression molding. It is a method of preparing suppositories from a mixed mass of grated suppository boats and medicaments, which is forced into a special compression mold. Okay. So here, this under this compression molding, the method is same like your hand molding. Okay. Till what? So you need to take, you need to weigh your cocoa butter followed by your API. Both should be transferred to a motor. After transferring to a motor, you need to grate it. Okay. After grating it, after grating this suppository, you will be getting a plastic mass. This particular special compression mold, a special compression mold will be there. What do you mean by compression? Compression in the nothing but putting pressure onto a machine so that your suppository will get ejected outside. Do you remember while during your festivals and all, you will be preparing some eatables? There will be a mold that containing plates below having some small design holes and all. Inside that particular cylindrical mold, you will be keeping your plastic mass, and thereby when you apply pressure onto that particular mold, you will be getting your required eatables. In the same way, here also there is a compression mold for the preparation of your suppository. First, you need to prepare a plastic-like mass. That particular plastic-like mass, after obtaining enough consistency, should be put into that particular mold. There, when you put some pressure onto that mold, your suppositories will start get ejecting outside. The method requires that the capacity of the molds first be determined by compressing a small amount of the base into the dies and weighing the finished suppository. So here the capacity of the mold is also very important. So what is the weight of your suppository you are expecting? Okay. And what is the size of the suppository? Both the things are important. So first you need to fill some small amount of base into the dies of the mold, and after that you need to weigh the suppository. One suppository will get ejected outside, right? So after that you need to weigh it, whether it is 1 gram or what is the weight exactly. When it is 1.5 gram, that means that you need to understand that what is our expected gram? 1 gram. What we have got here? 1.5 gram. What you need to do? You need to reduce the size of your die so that you will get exactly 1 gram. This particular trials will take about 5 to 10 trials to optimize your weight of your suppository. Okay. So when active ingredients are added, it is necessary to omit a portion of the suppository base based on the density factors of the active ingredients. When you add active ingredients to your suppository base, when you want to test, when you want to fix exactly what is the weight of the suppository, sometimes you need to omit some portion of your suppository base. Why you need to omit some portion? Because you need to ensure that whatever the expected weight that you are looking for, that is obtained or not. That is about your compression molding. Are you clear with the concept of compression molding? Next comes your fusion molding. Next comes fusion molding. It involves first melting the suppository base and then dispersing or dissolving the drug in the melted base. What is the first thing that you need to do? First, you need to take your cocoa butter followed by your API. Okay, first you need to weigh it. After weighing, what you need to do? First, you need to melt your suppository base. After melting your suppository base, to that, you need to add your drug in the melted base by dispersing or dissolve. So here there are two things, ma'am. Some drugs will get dissolved into your base, some drugs will get dispersed into the base. The mixture is removed from the heat and poured into a suppository mold. When the mixture has congealed, the suppositories are removed from the mold. So after melting, what you are going to do? So that particular mixture, okay, it should be removed from the heat and it should be poured into the suppository mold. So after pouring into the suppository mold, when the mixture get concealed, that is, concealed is nothing but setting of your mixture. When the setting has been done, then you can remove your suppositories from the mold. The fusion method can be used with all types of suppository and must be used with most of them. Most of the suppositories nowadays will be used with a method called as fusion molding. And whatever method we have adopted in our laboratory, it
Sir,
these are three methods of preparation of your suppositories. Okay, the first method is hand molding method, the second method is compression molding method, the third method is fusion molding method. Okay, first method, hand molding method, how you are going to do? Just you are going to grate your cocoa butter and API in a mortar, then converting into a plastic like mass, then after that converting into a ball like mass, after that converting into a cylinder like mass, then after that cut it into a small pieces, then rolling at one end to form a conical shape. That is your hand molding method. Coming to your compression molding method, because here in the you will be taking help of a compression mold. Okay, you are going to grate your cocoa butter along with your API, you are going to prepare a plastic mass, and that particular plastic mass is put it into the mold where you are going to get your suppositories. Okay, the exact weight of the suppository can be checked, okay, before weighing the finished suppositories. Okay, so for this, what happens, you know, some amount of portion of the suppository may get omitted. Okay, that is not a problem, but our expected weight should be obtained at the final end. And fusion molding is nothing but first you need.
Sorry, our call has been muted, sir.
Yeah, coming to the fusion molding, first what you need to do, weigh cocoa butter as well as your API. First you need to melt your suppository base. To that melted suppository base, you need to add what, your API. After adding your API, you need to just on heating, you need to add all this. After that, from heating, you need to remove it and you need to pour it into the mold till your mixture or mass will get concealed. After getting concealed, you need to remove from the mold. And this fusion molding method is applied for all the types of the suppositories on this particular modern world. Now we'll discuss this method of preparation with boric acid suppository. Any question that comes from method of preparation of suppositories, first you need to make a note on three methods of preparations followed by an example. So boric acid suppository, RX, boric acid 1.2 gram, cocoa butter sufficient to produce 9.2 gram, make suppository, and direction, insert one suppository to rectum as directed. This is a RX for your boric acid suppository. So first thing, use and nature of the ingredients employed. That is nothing but theory about your boric acid suppository. So any formulation need to be started, first what we need to discuss is your theory about the RX. Okay, so these suppositories contain an insoluble solid like boric acid. We know that boric acid is insoluble in nature. And what is the use of boric acid? It acts as an anti-infective. In this preparation, cocoa butter is used as a base. Especially, what is main category of your cocoa butter? It is comes under the category of oily base or oligogenous base or fatty base also, in which boric acid is insoluble. Therefore, suppositories are prepared by dispersing boric acid in the melted base by fusion method. We know that boric acid is insoluble in nature, and the base what you are going to take here, cocoa butter, and it is an oily base. Ultimately, your boric acid is insoluble in your oily base. So what we need to do? Ultimately, we need to adopt a method called as fusion method. Why we need to adopt a method called as fusion method? First, we need to melt your cocoa butter, followed by on melting, you need to add your boric acid to the melted base. This is the concept. In this preparation, heating of cocoa butter is very important. So, as we have discussed many times till now, cocoa butter plays an important role. Okay, why? Because it acts as a base. What is the main disadvantage of your cocoa butter? The main disadvantage of your cocoa butter is with the melting point. Okay, so heating of cocoa butter is very important. It solidifies into different polymorphic crystalline forms when melted and cooled. Do you remember in the previous slides when I am discussing about your cocoa butter base, I have discussed advantages and disadvantages. What is the main disadvantage of your cocoa butter? The main disadvantage is polymorphism, change of one form to the other form. Do you remember I already told you that your cocoa butter may change from one form to the another forms, like stable. There are three types of forms: stable, metastable and unstable. When the melting is too less, it will get converted into one form. When the melting is When the melting is too high, it will get converted into the other form. And when the melting is optimum, it will get converted into another form. So total three forms are there. We don't know which form is stable and which form is metastable and which form is unstable. So that's the major problem with your cocoa butter when melted as well as and cooled. Okay, on cooling it may get converted into three different forms. On melting also it may get different polymorphic forms. These polymorphs may exist as stable and metastable forms depending on the temperature of melting and rate of cooling. Okay, this is the statement here. So I said you like it will change into different polymorphic forms. These polymorphic forms, especially they act as stable and metastable forms depending upon the melting and cooling. So here it has been clearly given the nomenclature now: polymorphic form, gamma form, alpha form, beta form. Okay, two beta forms are beta form, normal beta form and beta one form. Okay, nature: when it is in the gamma form, it is a metastable one. The temperature is 18 degrees. When the melting temperature is 18 degrees, ultimately what happens? It will go to metastable form. Okay, what do you mean by metastable? We don't know that when this metastable will get converted into stable, and the time when it gets converted from metastable to stable, we don't know that. The formulation still holds its properties. Okay, alpha form, again metastable, the melting point is 22 degrees. Beta one form, again it's a metastable and the melting point is 28 degrees. The optimum temperature, melting temperature to be maintained is 34.5 degrees centigrade. Then only your cocoa butter will be in a stable form. That is nothing but beta form. If cocoa butter is melted at less than 36 degrees centigrade and slowly cooled, it forms a stable beta form which melts at body temperature. In laboratory also, I told you that don't go for overheating of your cocoa butter. When you go for overheating of cocoa butter, what happens? I told you that it will undergo charring. Okay, charring is the thing where it will be visible to the eyes. Okay, foul smell where it will be visible to the eyes. But what happens within your cocoa butter is change of its forms where it is not visible to our eyes. Okay, so it seems that your suppository is good. Its suppository is good, and it seems that all your evolution parameters were good. Okay, when you give it for shelf life or storage, it will undergo degradation. The form of your suppository is very important, ma. Whether your cocoa butter is in which form, metastable form or stable form. So it will be in stable form when you heat it up to 37 degrees and when you slowly cool down, then only it will form stable beta form. Clear? If cocoa butter is overheated above 37 degrees, after cooling, it forms metastable polymorphs, which melts at temperature 15 to 20 degrees centigrade. These metastable forms return to stable form after several days, but these suppositories become unsuitable for use. When you go for overheating beyond 36 degrees, ultimately it will result in the formation of metastable forms. Leave about at what temperature it will melt. It melts at 15 to 20 degree, 22 degrees centigrade, but these metastable forms slowly after the days goes on, it will return to stable form. Okay, after 7 days, 10 days or 15 days. But at that particular time point, till that point, your suppository will not be a position to show its desirable properties. It may become unsuitable for use. Okay, are you clear with the concept? Yeah. Next, Therefore, cocoa butter is melted on a water bath only 2/3 of its quantity and then immediately removed from the heat, and remaining base is melted with constant stirring. This avoids overheating of cocoa butter. So what we need to do in order to avoid overheating of your cocoa butter, always cocoa butter should be melted on a water bath. Okay, in order to melt your cocoa butter, how much quantity to be taken? Initially, you need to take 2/3 quantity. Then after taking 2/3 quantity, immediately or after melting, immediately you need to remove from the heat. Then you need to add the remaining base to it by constant stirring. This avoids overheating of cocoa butter. This is one way where we can avoid overheating of cocoa butter. Lubrication of mold is necessary because cocoa butter has the tendency of sticking to the sides of the mold. Always ensure that that particular mold into which your suppository mass to be poured, that particular mold should be lubricated. Okay, why it should be lubricated? Because to ensure that your cocoa butter will not stick to the walls of your mold. Hence, lubricant Hence, lubricant containing combination of soft soap, glycerin and alcohol is used. Since cocoa butter contracts after cooling, it leads to formation of hollow depression at the center top of the suppositories. Hence, to avoid this problem, mold is overfilled and excess of base is trimmed off horizontal after setting using a sharp knife or blade. And there is one more observation here. So you have grated your cocoa butter, okay, in a china dish, and you have melted on a water bath. Okay, only 2/3 quantity of cocoa butter is added to the water bath, to the china dish. On that china dish placed on a water bath. After melting, what you will do, you just remove the china dish from the water bath. And after that, you will be adding the remaining quantity while constant stirring. Then after this, you are going to pour this particular mass into your molds, which are already lubricated. Okay, lubricated with what? Soft soap, glycerin and alcohol. Are you clear till this? So you should not pour this particular mass till the brim of your mold. Always you need to pour excess. When you don't pour excess, what happens? You know, cocoa butter has a property of contraction. After pouring, it will start congealing. Congealing is nothing but setting. That is nothing but on contraction, what happens? It will leave a hollow depression. In order to avoid that, what we need to do, always you ensure that pour some extra amount onto the mold so that that particular extra amount should be trimmed off, okay, horizontal after setting using a sharp knife or blade. So while doing your laboratory, already I taught you how to pour your suppository mass into them. Always ensure that you pour some extra amount after setting up. You need to trim the extra amount with the knife or sharp knife or blade. Okay, by this you can avoid what? You can avoid hollow depression at the center top of your suppositories. So always take warm slab tile is used for levigation of boric acid and cocoa butter to prevent rapid cooling and solidification of the base during mixing. Always, not only this melting on china dish and all, also you can take a warm slab tile, a tile that is warm, okay? It is used for levigation is nothing but mixing of an insoluble powder on wet. Mixing of an insoluble, here insoluble powder is your boric acid and cocoa butter. When you add cocoa butter to warm slab tile, what happens? It will start melting, right? To that you add your boric acid and start mixing. That particular process is nothing but called as levigation. Okay, so when you do this, it will prevent rapid cooling and solidification of the base during mixing. You can avoid rapid cooling and solidification of the base during mixing. So this is everything about the theory about your boric acid suppository. So in that theory, the most important points are your boric acid, insoluble, cocoa butter, oily base, and you need to discuss something about cocoa butter melting. So when you over melt or when you melt at a lower rate, what happens? It will end up with polymorphism. what are the four different types of polymers? Gamma, beta 1, beta and alpha. So which one will be the stable form? The stable form will be your beta form. Okay, you explain that. After explaining that, in what way the lubrication is necessary for your cocoa butter, in what way you need to mix, in what way you need to grate. So how much quantity of cocoa butter to be taken initially and what to be added next. And when you pour it into the mold, how much to be poured? It should be poured excess. All these things should be discussed under theory. Okay, clear? Next, procedure. Coming to the procedure for the preparation of your boric acid suppository. First point, calculate the quantities of ingredients required by taking displacement value of the medicament into account to manipulate the practical losses during preparation. So always calculate the quantity of ingredients by taking displacement value of the medicament into account. If you can check your syllabus, displacement value and its calculations, it is there in your syllabus. We will discuss as a separate chapter. Okay, in order to avoid practical loss, see, like your powders, liquids or whatever it is, will weigh one extra powder packet, right? In order to compensate your practical loss, in the same way here also, you need to consider displacement value for the calculation of the base for your suppositories. Okay, so after this particular completion of these methods of preparation of your suppository, tomorrow's session we will discuss with the displacement value and its calculation. Okay, to manipulate the practical losses during preparation and for overfilling of the mold, calculate quantities of ingredients for two extra suppositories than prescribed number. It is a usual practice. Okay, every time when the formulator is asked to prepare 10 suppositories, you need to calculate for two extra quantity. That is a usual process. But how much amount of the base should be taken for that particular suppository, that will be based upon the displacement value calculation. Okay. Second point, clean the suppository mold with hot water and detergent. This is the first step. Finally, rinse with water. First, what you need to do, take a suppository mold. You need to clean it with hot water and detergent. And after cleaning with hot water and detergent, you need to rinse with water. Dry it thoroughly, then go for lubrication. After lubrication, invert on the ice. Just you need to invert the molds on the ice to drain the excess of lubricant and cool the mold. Okay, first what you need to do, you just need to wash it with hot water. After washing with hot water, you need to wash it with the detergent. After washing with this both, you need to finally rinse with water. After rinsing with water, you need to lubricate it. After lubricating it, you need to just invert on the ice. Why to invert on the ice? To drain the excess of lubricant. Because when there is more amount of lubricant in the mold, ultimately your suppositories will start slipping from the mold. Okay. So next, third one, grate or shred the cocoa butter into small pieces. First, you need to grate it into small pieces and transfer to a china dish. And heat it over a water bath until only 2/3 of the base has melted, and then remove it from the heat. Melt remaining portion of the base with constant stirring by spatula. Okay, what you need to, first you need to grate the cocoa butter, and after that you need to transfer to a china dish. After transferring to a china dish, heat 2/3 quantity of your cocoa butter. When it gets melt, it has to be removed from the heat. Then after that, what you need to do, you need to add the remaining portion. Okay, you need to add it and you need to melt the base with constant stirring by spatula. Then heat the clean slab tile. Okay, just take a clean slab tile. You need to heat it until it becomes warm to the hand. Place the weighed amount of boric acid on warm tile and pour the half the portion of the melted cocoa butter and leave it. Mix them as quickly as possible using flexible spatula and then transfer to the dish. Stir to form a homogeneous mixture and cool until it becomes thick to pourable. So what you need to do? You need to take a clean slab tile. Okay. So, and you need to heat it until it becomes warm. Okay. You need to touch with the hand. You need to feel some warm onto the tile. Okay. Then after ensuring that particular tile is warm. Okay. What you need to do? You need to place the weighed amount of boric acid on warm tile. After placing weighed amount of boric acid on warm tile, you need to pour half of the portion of your cocoa butter, okay, onto that particular tile containing your boric acid, and you need to go for levigation as quickly as possible using spatula. Take a spatula and just you need to levigate. And then immediately transfer to the dish. Stir to form a homogeneous mixture and cool until it just becomes thick to pourable. Okay, when it becomes just thick to pourable, pour the dispersion into each cavity to overflowing. Just immediately pour it into each cavity to overflowing. Care must be taken to stir the mass continuously to ensure the even distribution of the medicament. Always you need to ensure that the mass is stirred continuously while pouring. Okay, it is not like you stop stirring and just you keep on pouring onto the molds. One mold up, then immediately you keep on stirring that so that it will just fill it into the molds. Otherwise, it will lead to sedimentation of insoluble solids in melted mass. When you don't stir, what happens? It will result in sedimentation because, as you said, boric acid is insoluble in nature. Finally, it will sediment at the bottom of your china dish. Okay. So ultimately, that suppository will look like small boric acid sedimented at the bottom or top portion of your suppository. What we require is uniform distribution of your boric acid inside your suppository dose. Okay. Next point. Leave it for 2 to 3 minutes until the mass has just set. Trim off the excess from the mold horizontally using sharp knife or razor blade. Trimming at this stage produces a clean cut which cannot be obtained when the mass has become hard. So when you after pouring it pouring into the molds, just leave for 1 to 2 minutes. Okay, wait for the time where your mass get concealed, something called a setting into the mold. After that, immediately you just take a sharp knife or blade and just trim the excess portion. Okay, so always you need to ensure that after 1 to 2 minutes, you need to just trim off the excess portion. If you leave for more time, ultimately when it becomes hard, you cannot trim the excess portion and you cannot get the smooth cut on the suppository. After trimming, keep the mold for half an hour in a refrigerator on an ice, then open the mold and remove the suppository. So after trimming, what you are going to just you need to subject to a refrigerator for half an hour on ice, then open the mold and remove the suppository. Next point, blot, wipe the excess lubricant if present by rolling the suppository on cellulose tissue paper or clean cloth. So after removing that particular suppository from the mold, what you need to do, you need to just roll your suppository on a tissue paper. Okay, that is nothing but called as blotting. Blotting is nothing but called as wiping the excess lubricant that is present on the suppository. This is the procedure involved in the preparation of your suppository. So coming to the procedure, what you need to do, first you need to take your suppository molds, you need to clean it with hot water and detergent. After cleaning with hot water and detergent, you need to rinse it with water. After rinsing with water, you need to invert on the ice to ensure that excess amount of the water that is present on the suppository get drained off. After that, you need to lubricate the suppositories. After lubrication, you need to just again you need to invert on the ice so that excess lubricant will get drained off. That is very important. Then after, see, anything to get loose from the your molds, you need to just subject to the ice so that whatever excess is there, excess amount, either it may be lubricant, either it may be water, will get drained off. After that, what you need to do, you need to just grate your cocoa butter. Okay, how much amount of cocoa butter you need to take? At least 2/3. You need to transfer to a china dish and you start melting on a water bath. When it gets melted, so you need to take it from the heating and you need to add the remaining. On melting, you need to just stir it so that the remaining base will get melted. Okay, and after that, you need to take a clean tile. Okay, slab of tile, that clean slab of tile to be taken, and it should be heated to get warmed up. You need to just experience that warm by with the help of your hand. When the tile is warm, then to that warm tile you need to transfer some amount your weighed amount of your boric acid. Then after that, add the half the portion of your previously melted cocoa butter to that. So go for levigating. Okay, as soon as possible. After levigating your boric acid with your cocoa butter, just immediately transfer to the dish again, back to the dish, and stir continuously and homogeneously. Then after that, you need to stir until it is thick and pourable. When it is thick and pourable, immediately start transferring your mass into your suppository molds. And when you transfer the mass into your suppository mold, excess amount of the mass should be transferred to each mold to avoid hollow depressions. Okay, after transferring excess of your mass into each mole of your suppository, wait for 1 to 2 minutes. Just then you can trim off the excess portion with the help of sharp knife or blade. Then after that, go for refrigeration for half an hour. Okay, or if refrigerator is not available, you can just go for subjecting to an ice. Then open the mold, remove the suppositories. After removing the suppositories, you need to just blot the suppository. Blotting is nothing but wiping the suppositories using your tissue paper or any clean cloth, so that excess amount of the lubricant will get absorbed onto the tissue paper or clean cloth. Storage: wrap individual suppositories in wax paper and put it in partition box or in wide mouth container. Close it tightly with plastic screw cap and label. So after preparation of your suppositories, you need to go for storage. That's so it can be stored in wax paper, or after storing, wrapping in a wax paper, you can just put it into a partition box, or it can also be transferred into a wide mouth container. Then close it tightly with plastic screw cap and label it. Direction: insert one suppository to rectum as directed. Storage condition: store in a cool place. Storage conditions: store in a cool place, or store in refrigerator, or store in cold temperature. These are the storage conditions. Next, auxiliary label: for rectal use only, store in a cool place or store in refrigerator. These are your auxiliary labels. Uses: boric acid suppositories are used as local anti-infective. What is the use of boric acid suppositories? These are used as local anti-infective. When you say local anti-infective, that means that boric acid suppositories are meant for localized action. As I said you, that suppositories are meant for both localized as well as system